Okay, now let's go ahead and talk about exchange rates. And for right now, let's go ahead and talk about what we call the nominal exchange rate. So the nominal exchange rate is the one you're going to hear reported in the newspaper, and it can be reported either in foreign currency units per dollar or dollars per foreign currency unit. Both are equally fine. We're going to go ahead and discuss it in terms of foreign currency units per dollar. And I'm going to go ahead and parallel the Mankiw textbook here and go ahead and think about yen. So we might have the exchange rate be 100 yen per dollar. Or we might have it be 120 yen per dollar, and we could go ahead and have it be 80 yen per dollar. And let's think about some item that costs $10. So if it costs $10 in the US, if the exchange rate is 80 yen per dollar, then for Japanese consumers, it costs 8,000 yen. And if it's 100 yen per dollar, then for Japanese consumers, it costs 10,000 yen. And up here, we're up at 12,000 yen. So, two things to notice here. When this exchange rate rises, the higher or stronger dollar we talk about, or when the dollar appreciates, then US goods become more expensive. And if we did an example where we were looking at Japanese goods and translating them into dollars, we would also see that foreign goods become cheaper. So that's going to impact the relative demand for US goods versus foreign goods. So we're going to go ahead and see that, at least in the short run, this is going to impact, or the medium run maybe, this is going to impact net exports. And I'm going to now ignore that sort of thing that I alluded to with the J-shaped curve. And we're just going to think about the fact that US goods become more expensive, foreign goods become cheaper, and that's going to mean that US net exports, which are exports minus imports, US net exports are going to go ahead and do what? Well, if US goods become more expensive, then US exports are going to fall because foreign buyers don't want as much of them. And if foreign goods become cheaper, then imports are going to rise. So overall, net exports are going to go down. So they're going to become, in the case of the US, more negative because we're already running a trade deficit. So this idea of is a stronger or weaker currency a good thing or a bad thing, a little bit depends. If you're really worried about the trade deficit, a stronger dollar is actually a bad thing. So that's one thing to keep about here. So one way of looking at exchange rates is to look at a market for exchange rates. And we can have a supply and demand curve. And we have the price of a dollar. So this is the market for dollars. And we could equivalently talk about the market for yen, and that would be just fine too. It would be basically the inverse of that. And this would be the quantity of dollars. And again, the price of a dollar we measure in terms of yen per dollar. Well, where does the demand for dollars come from? Well, the demand for dollars in the foreign exchange market, demand comes from Japanese or other foreign people who want to buy things that are sold in dollars. So most obviously, that's U.S.-produced goods and services, because U.S. producers pay their workers and suppliers in dollars, and so they want to be paid in dollars. So, if more people want to go to Disneyland, that increases the demand for dollars. Or if more people want, you know, Harley Davidsons or something like that, that increases the demand for dollars. Less obviously, if you want to buy stocks on the U.S. stock market, or if you want to buy real estate in the U.S., you need dollars to do that. So, U.S. assets also generate demand for dollars. Because basically, when you think about it, there's only two things you can do with a country's currency. You can buy their assets, or you can buy their goods. And when you're buying their assets, actually, what you're doing is you're preserving your stockpile of dollars and hopefully making some income, but of course that income is also going to be paid in dollars. So essentially there's really only one thing you can do with a country's currency: buy their goods. It could be their goods now, or it could be their goods later, but eventually that's all U.S. dollars are useful for. So where's the supply of dollars come from? Well, supply of dollars comes from U.S. firms and households who want to buy foreign goods, you know, foreign is Japanese in this case, but we're using the yen, of course, as a stand-in for all countries, so who want to buy foreign goods or foreign assets. Because again, you know, if you want to buy foreign goods, those foreign suppliers want to be paid in dollars. Or if you want to buy stock on the Tokyo stock market, well, those things are priced in dollars. So let's go ahead and think about a sort of supply and demand problem here. So let's suppose that now we're thinking about the price of a dollar, and now we're going to think about euros. Let's see, let me get the euro symbol right here. I think that's roughly it. Euros per dollar. And what's going to happen here if people become more optimistic that the euro is going to stay together and be stable? Well, presumably, U.S. investors will want to buy more euros and euro-denominated assets. So U.S. investors are going to supply more of their dollars because they need to sell dollars to get them exchanged for euros so they can get U.S. assets. So we would predict that if this happens, and if people think that the euro is likely to be more stable, that is going to push down the value of the dollar relative to the euro. We could describe that as the dollar strengthening, we could describe that as the dollar weakening, or we could describe that as the euro strengthening. So, higher demand, assets means higher supply of dollars in exchange markets, which means weaker dollar. And then that would correspondingly affect net exports. In particular, this weaker dollar would eventually, we think, lead to higher net exports. So there's one example of that kind of market going on.